Hey everyone, thanks for downloading the show. As you know, this show couldn't exist without your generous support. So if you'd like to contribute and support the show, head over to the BrainsMatter website and click on one of the green donation buttons. There are a few donation options available. You can donate in US or Australian dollars, but if you have any other currency, don't worry, those will be automatically converted over. Remember, this is your show, and without your support, it wouldn't be possible. Now on to the episode. Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. I've got Dr. Zara Dennis here with me today. Once again, she's been on the podcast before, so if you want to listen to a previous interview, go back and listen to that in the archives. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
So you've been up to a lot since we've last spoken, so can you take us a little bit through that? So just to give the listeners a bit of an idea, we're sitting inside a university lecture room, I guess, and she's just given a lecture to a bunch of primary school students, and I'm sure she'll get onto that.
Grade 3 to 4. So yeah, so last time we were sat up in the hills in Olinda and discussing predominantly my PhD and my transfer from academia into education. And in many ways, now sat in a university classroom in my pilot's uniform is a continuation of that in many ways. First of all, my background, and again, certainly can go back and listen to the previous podcast. I moved to Australia in 2008 to complete my PhD in geophysics. Previous to that, my undergraduate degree was in physics. So definitely a heavy science background, and that in itself, nothing has changed. I'm still a big science nerd. I'm still very proud of that fact, and I still love everything science, and more so sharing that with anybody who will let me. Mm-hmm. And certainly enthusiastic groups of teenagers, and as it's been today's primary school children, they are the perfect group for sharing something that I'm massively passionate about, and watching them be infected with the same love of science and physics as I am myself.
So you mentioned your pilot's uniform. How does that fit into the education?
Flying is something that has always interested me. I can remember being a small child of about 4 or 5, and Concorde actually came to land at Leeds and Bradford Airport. I don't remember a massive amount of Concorde itself, being only 4 or 5 years old, but I do remember very clearly running around the car park with my arms out going, and pretending to be a plane, as you do when you're 4 or 5. So that sticks in my
memory. I know 24 and 25 year olds do that too.
And then when I was 12 years old, that was the first time I was in a light aircraft. 12 years old, it was actually my dad's birthday, but of course, you know, being the 12-year-old daughter, somehow I got the pilot's seat. And probably for about 5 minutes, I actually held the aircraft in straight and level flight. It's actually quite possible that the pilot instructor had the plane on autopilot, and I thought I was holding it on straight and level flight, but it doesn't matter. I've got a certificate that said I flew a plane, so it was there. And certainly having a background in physics, aviation, you don't need to try very hard to make a link. Certainly there's massive overlaps without even trying between physics and aviation. And I remember as well, whilst I was at university in the UK doing my physics degree, one of my best friends at uni, all the way through, the only reason she was doing physics was because she wanted to be an airline pilot. Well, a decade later, she has been 100% successful in that, and she has very recently become a captain of EasyJet, one of the budget airlines in Europe. So there's always been people around that have been interested, and all that time at uni, whilst my friend was gunning for the airlines, I was more, I'm going to learn to fly one day. I will do it. I'm going to get round to it. I will. And then eventually, not long after we last spoke, I managed to make that one day came. And how this all links together? Well, certainly I love science. I love teaching and sharing that. And the second I did a flying lesson at Lilydale, that was it. The fuel was already there. That ignited it, and I caught the aviation bug badly. It's great. I'm now about halfway through doing my CPL or my commercial pilot's license. I've done 4 of the 7 exams required for that, and I've got about 30 more hours of command time flying that I need to do before my instructor scrubs me up ready for my test. Hopefully we're looking early next year if everything goes to plan. And again, given the love of teaching, there's a certain inevitability that I will probably end up doing an instructor rating quite quickly afterwards, simply because I enjoy it. Now, that's flying covered, that's science covered. We've previously talked about education. How on earth has all this ended up with us sat here at Swinburne? Again, not long after we met, and Yvonne was previously the head of science at the school where I was working, and she recognised this enthusiasm and this genuine passion and infectiousness of that I wanted to share, and put me forward for a growing teacher tall Poppies award, mm-hmm. which was actually run out of Melbourne University. And one thing led to another, and I was one of 3 of the inaugural winners of that award in 2015. As part of that, apart from obviously that was fantastic, award-winning science teacher, that sounds pretty cool. It wasn't just an award. As part of that, we actually had to do some work. We had to earn our award, I guess. Mm-hmm. And part of that was to come up with a project that we could implement within our school or outside of school, but something to do with education. And the idea I initially came up with was to do a hands-on STEM elective. So I'd certainly seen a few examples, particularly with a group of year 10s, we'd entered the Melbourne University Amazing Spaghetti Machine Contest, which is basically to build a Rube Goldberg machine. Did this 2 years in a row.
What's the Goldberg machine?
So the Rube Goldberg machine, it's one of the machines where a marble may hit some dominoes and the dominoes trigger the next stage.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And as many energy transformations as possible.
Mm-hmm.
The first year we did it, we went in, we weren't really expecting anything, and somehow we were joint winners. I was like, mm-hmm. wow, that's great. Let's go back again next year. Contest champions and People's Choice Awards. So, and I've watched this group of year 10 girls, and the amount that they learnt and the teamwork was just amazing, just through this process of entering this competition, the working together, the problem solving, very much like we've just witnessed here with the activity I've had the grade 3 to 4s doing,
mm-hmm.
just an older student version thereof. It was that, from that, to do something hands-on with STEM, being active, that sort of where my idea was for my project. Then with involvement in aviation, by this time I actually had, alongside I'd started doing my flying lessons, that was creeping its way into many other things. It's like, okay, we're doing maths, we need to talk about bearings. I glance at the board that's currently in front of me with aviation bearings drawn on it, and I was using that as an example and an applied way to teach bearings in my maths lessons. I was using aviation as an example, and I couldn't hide the enthusiasm. It was just, it leaked out, but that was no bad thing, because here's something very applied for all of this science, this maths, this STEM that we're doing.
And that also gets rid of the criticism that some people have of, when am I ever going to use this?
Absolutely. There's many, many examples. And again, trigonometry is one of the classic ones where students will go, when am I ever going to use this? Well,
have you ever played pool?
Have you ever played pool? Have you ever tried to land a plane in a crosswind?
Yeah.
It's great applied examples.
Mm.
Again, the exact moment when I got this idea of starting to do the school holiday programs for my project, which has been called Sci Fly STEM Outreach. Little plug there is a little website for it.
I'll put a link in it on the interview page.
Fantastic. But yeah, I mean, again, and on there, as well as doing school holiday programs, there are resources that I'm starting to build. In particular, there's a full set of year 10 physics lessons,
mm-hmm.
which can be downloaded completely free of charge for teachers to use. And in there, I've put as many little hands-on kind of applications. And that idea and those particular year 10 physics lessons were actually built on the pedagogy of the Growing Tall Poppies project, which was where the award came from.
Yep.
And that really sort of gave my idea its first breath of life, if you like, that I can use not only hands-on applied physics and hands-on applied science, but I can specifically use aviation as a mechanism to get this out and encourage more students, girls in particular, because in physics and in aviation there is they're not exactly equal percentages. Mm. I believe middle of last year, the count was only 4% of Qantas's pilots are women. So there's definitely room there for improving that. But at the same time, certainly looking at around the room today, we've had probably a pretty even 50-50 split of girls and boys because it's there for everybody. The idea then, this idea that I could combine flying and teaching and science and sharing that and things that I was just genuinely passionate about myself, combine them all into this SciFly STEM outreach project. And it was PrimeSci, who are now based at Swinburne, hence why we're at Swinburne, that gave it that first real applied chance.
So did they hear about you, or how did that happen?
The director of PrimeSci is a professor in the geosciences, which is what my PhD was in, and we met
Professor Vickers-Rich, who yes. You can go back and listen to her interviews as well.
Absolutely. So we just bumped into each other in the coffee shop. Like, hey, Zara, hi, Pat, how are you going? Not seeing you for 4 years. What are you up to? And that just kind of led to me mentioning this idea that I had of doing outreach. But the unique twist and the sort of the grand plan that I had was that PrimeSci are already doing amazing stuff and doing some great programs for students in Melbourne metropolitan areas. But I could take what they were doing and some new ideas. Given that I now had my private pilot's license, I could jump in a plane and take that out to a rural community where the kids wouldn't normally have that opportunity to come in. And it was that mention that it was like, all right, let's see what we can do. Let's do it. So PrimeSci gave the project sort of that first breath of life, and hence why we're maintaining that relationship now and the programs that I'm doing for primary school students, mm-hmm. primary PrimeSci. What I do for the primary school students, I'm running it in conjunction with PrimeSci. So it's my material, my aviation knowledge, my physics background, combined with, you know, my teaching experience, and running that, PrimeSci then are helping out with the bookings and things like that, and it's a win-win because we've, you know, it's giving them some extra programs, but it's also getting my project, it's out there at the primary school level. Then the amazing thing happened that somehow the Women in Aviation International, the Australia chapter, or WAI as the shorter version, WAI Australia, I got an email. It might have even been a Facebook message, I think, from the national president saying, hi, this is really cool. We'd like to support you. The next thing I know, I was being invited to present at the inaugural WAI Australia conference in Brisbane in October last year. And that was when I formally launched SciFly STEM Outreach as it exists now. Still certainly keeping strong to its original roots with PrimeSci. Again, you know, anything for primary school, it does belong as a joint venture. But with the women in aviation involved, we've really got that opportunity to get that airborne component of it going. And in November last year, we did our first trial run of the airborne component. And myself and a young 19-year-old commercial pilot by the name of Scott, who also flies at Lilydale, mm-hmm. we jumped in a plane and flew ourselves to Witchyproof.
Yeah, so where's that for those who aren't in Victoria or Australia?
Witchyproof is a rural township in north central Victoria, just over an hour's flight there, mm-hmm. a significantly longer drive. Then there's not, you know, there's one road in, one road out kind of town, and also the train line that runs straight through the middle of town. So we flew ourselves up there. It was a bit of an adventure in itself because at the moment, because of the level of pilot experience that both Scott and myself has, neither of us have instrument ratings, so we needed the skies to be clear, or at least the cloud high enough that we could get north over the ranges. Mm-hmm. So it was a bit of a delayed start, but fortunately we got up to Kilmore, which is the key gap in the ranges, and then it was beautiful blue skies all the rest of the way. So it was a lovely flight up there, and there was something very, very special about arriving at Witchyproof. The airstrip's only about a kilometre away from the town, but overflying the school as a hello, we're here, then going to land, and Scott was watching out as I was landing, and he says, yep, there's a car set off from the school, which indeed it actually was, the science teacher setting off to pick us up from the airstrip. Walked into the school, and again, it was fantastic, and that was, you know, sort of the proof of concept that this airborne idea can actually work. So,
and I can imagine as a, you know, a primary school student, you know that you're going to learn about aviation and science, and then you see the teacher come in on a plane, That's just a whole different level, isn't it?
Absolutely. And as we walked into the school, I mean, again, this was the first one we've done, so Scott and I weren't in proper uniform. You know, we were still scrubbed up in appropriate teacher attire, mm-hmm. But it was kind of all a bit new, and we were just testing it out. And we walked into the school, and the kids are like looking at each other. Are you the pilots? And especially the bit that really stood out was the two pilots that were there. One's a girl and the other's a 19-year-old boy. Not exactly the stereotypes, mm-hmm. which is perfect.
Yeah.
And say certainly with the programs that I did here with PrimeSci on Friday and today, that some of the girls in particular who've taken part, it's just like, but can you be a pilot? But you're a girl, can you be a pilot? And it's like, of course you can. Absolutely. So it is just even the, being the person delivering it, it breaks that stereotype that it absolutely is achievable. And Scott is also a wonderful person to have on board because he is only a kid himself.
Yeah.
The primary school kids absolutely adore him because they can just see the youth and the fact that, well, he's only 19, like he's only a little bit older than us. Mm-hmm. And his story of when he was 15 and taking a plane solo, but his mum's allowed to come and pick him up. That one always goes down really well.
So how did that first lesson go, apart from all that enthusiasm?
I think that's what it was. It was just running on adrenaline, I think, because it was just so exciting that we're actually doing this. We've just flown here. It was a year seven lesson. It was sort of a, I guess that lesson that we did is what has actually evolved into the aviation science lessons that I'm now running. It was at TIAB last week, and I've previously run it at Lilydale. A little bit of a look at forces of flight, but then also looking more specifically at aircraft controls, mm-hmm. running that from grades 5 up to year 8. So it's a little bit more advanced than what I've been doing today, just because the kids are just a little bit older. But some of the knowledge that they bring with them is absolutely outstanding. Walking around to the aircraft hangars, and the kids are like, oh, is this one of these, and is this one of these? And it's that kind of engine? Wow! The kids are just like, how do you know all this? That's fantastic. But their enthusiasm and the knowledge that they bring with them is something very special in itself.
And that's the sort of thing that we want to be able to encourage and foster.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when some of the questions that they'll come up with, and you can tell they've been reading up on all of their aircraft beforehand, and they'll ask a question, and it's just like, oh, what do you think's better? Isn't this plane or this plane's better? And I'm like, can I get back to you on that one? Especially when they're picking two planes that are completely different. It's like, you can't ask me which is better. It's just like they've got different characteristics, especially when we had the wonderful opportunity at TIAB. Judy Pay, who runs the old aeroplane company at TIAB, and her collection of warbirds. Some of the kids absolutely had a meltdown to see some of those old aircraft. It was an absolutely wonderful opportunity, and really, really appreciate both Judy Pay, her volunteers, and Peninsula Aero Club for allowing us to run 2 days of programs down there, and some very, very excited and lucky youngsters whose parents and grandparents, I think, were just a little bit jealous.
So it sounds like it's going really well. Where do you see this going next? You want to be able to take kids up to be able to experience it? Are you going to, you know, maybe mix some of your geography and geosciences as background with it and say, here's this kind of formation, here's this kind of formation while you're in the air?
That would be cool. I'm not really giving that one much thought, to be honest. But yeah, that's potential. Certainly in terms of flying, once I've got my commercial license complete, I am looking at doing an instructor rating. So then that would open up an opportunity, if run through, most likely would run through Lilydale, that there would be opportunity if students have participated in a program that then I could actually take them up and do a flying lesson with them. Mm-hmm. I mean, certainly on when we were down at TIAB, there was a girl and her mum, they hung around for a little chat afterwards. And her mum's like, well, she's 11 now. So if you're recommending starting flying when she's about 14 and a half, so will you have your instructor ready then so you can be her instructor? And I was like, oh, that's so cute. I was like, absolutely made my week. So certainly there is that avenue. In terms of the Sci-Fly project, what we've got running with the primary school programs in conjunction with PrimeSci, it's becoming quite robust now. Mm-hmm. We don't have very many sessions at the moment, but again, that is because it's new. And obviously with time we'll develop more, but certainly the ones we've done over the last of these in these holidays, they've been incredibly well received, and that's nothing but encouraging, and we'll continue to do that. You know, we've got a really good partnership here, so that will undoubtedly continue. And then for the project on the grand scale, I guess, working directly with the Women in Aviation Australia group to take that more into the rural communities, that we'll get that option there, and especially as there's more pilots and potential to get more stereotype breaking pilots involved. But that said, there's individuals who from all corners, be they young pilots, girls, guys, the interest has been brilliant. It's like, well, if you need someone to help, you know, just let us know. So the interest there regardless, and if we can shatter stereotypes and show kids who in rural communities, and it's not just about aviation. I mean, yes, we're using aviation as the language, I guess, if you like, as the application, and this is what you can do. It is still about science and STEM in general. I mean, certainly, again, you know, I've already mentioned the link between physics and aviation, but then we can start talking about fuel. Went off on a tangent at tie-up talking about combustion engines. Mm-hmm. So talking there a little, you know, some basic chemistry in there and things like that. It links all very nicely. My next exam that I'm likely to do is the human factors exam, which is all the, you know, the biological things that happen to the human body when you're in flight. So, you know, it all links together, and it's a great applied tool that instantly sparks an interest with kids. And another one that we've not really investigated it particularly as of yet, but certainly it's an idea that has actually been put to us directly by parents. Again, this was done at TIAB, but it's also been done at Lilydale as well. And one of the Lilydale owner pilots who flies there, he was running a session for some scouts. Mm-hmm. Because the scouts, so they've got their aviation badges to do, and part of it's to visit an aerodrome and understand a few bits and pieces. And I think for the older ones, for the 15, 16 year olds, they actually have to do a flight plan, which is actually very involved if you don't know where to start with it. So I was helping one of the 11 year olds, and as you just mentioned, you know, the ground speed and the headwinds and things like that, understanding ground speed versus airspeed is actually one of the questions he actually had to tick off that he'd done. Mm-hmm. And so that's something that potentially we could sort of start looking at. There's scout groups everywhere, and if we can sort of offer an assistance, you know, they can actually get a pilot, and at the moment looking it'd be myself or Scott, that we could actually go and help them with this and actually sort of, you know, give it some real application and then sign them off for their badge.
So are you looking at different levels of the lessons you provide? So, for example, the one you did today, it was all about understanding, you know, a bit of mathematics, like the number of degrees in your directions and reading maps and things like that. And that was at the grade 3-4 level. You have multiple different steps as you build up the program.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's the sort of the grand plan at the end of it. We've had quite a few parents asking about kinders to twos. Mm-hmm. So I've got another friend who's a primary trained teacher who is looking at doing some programs for the younger kids, and then having Scott as the assistant, so they still get their real pilot in the mm-hmm. classroom. For myself, I am much more comfortable with the older kids. I'm happy with the grade 3-4s, and I love 5-6s. 5-6s are so much fun, and their knowledge is incredible at times. But certainly, taking it up to that next level, I've got a few ideas for the older kids, perhaps aimed at year 10s, actually looking at doing an actual flight plan, mm-hmm. which would involve some of what we've done today, but then actually then looking at speed, distance, time calculations, how much fuel the aircraft burns, and then actually sort of, you know, a full flight plan. What they've touched on today, yes, it's the beginning of it, but there is much more involved, which perhaps to do a full flight plan could actually be a good year 10 lesson. The idea's there, it just hasn't been quite finalised yet, but certainly the ideas are there.
So if there are any students or parents who are interested in the program, how do they find out more about it?
Well, my SciFly STEM Outreach website and Facebook page is obviously a good starting place. Mm-hmm. Again, I say for the primary school sessions, we're running them through PrimeSci. And the other big one, the big partner in all that is the Women in Aviation Group. So it's WAI Australia. So that's Women in Aviation International.
Yep.
And they, I mean, for example, an event that's going to be running that I'll be a part of, there's Girls in Aviation Day. That's running the first weekend of the next school holidays. And that's actually a global event. Mm-hmm. The Australia section of it will be running in Canberra, but like local groups sort of can get involved in things like that. And again, it's just to bring the numbers up on the number of girls.
Yep.
But at the same time, not at the exclusion of boys at all. Boys are also welcome to be involved in that. But it's the Women in Aviation Group, you know, they've really provided the springboard for what I'm trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
And again, we're working hand in hand for that. And I've been appointed as the Education Outreach Coordinator for the Australia chapter of the group. So what I'm doing as part of my SciFly STEM Outreach project, it all links hand in hand. So it gives it a real sort of nice, I guess it is a formality and partnership, but at the same time, you know, you can achieve far more through collaboration than you can on your own. So
for sure. So from when you first started doing this to now, have you noticed a change in the percentages of boys versus girls, or has it been reasonably even all the way through?
It's interesting that the younger groups that I've done, it's been more even.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the programs at the aerodromes, both at Lilydale and at Tyab, they've been very boy dominant.
Mm-hmm. So this might actually come back to what we were talking about before, and those comments you got about, oh wow, you're a girl and you're a pilot. As kids get older, the stereotypes start sinking in a bit more, whereas the younger kids are a bit more open. They're like, I can be anything.
Yeah, I guess that probably is quite accurate. And you try and work out and try and pinpoint where the stereotypes find their way. And certainly that model of the growing tall poppies that was set up, Arroyo, who's the director of that was her big message, that at year 10, students are choosing their VCE subjects.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can get more students to choose subjects like physics, it's not necessarily because we want to make more physicists. It's because of the options you have from having that physics background. I mean, certainly it's worked for me. I've done science, I've done teaching, I've done flying, I've done sport and exercise science as well. And it's, you know, it's a pathway subject.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they might want to be physicists as well. Cool. But if they don't, it doesn't hurt to do it because of the options. So I guess it's kind of working on that if you choose something in particular, that doesn't lock you to that.
Mm-hmm.
You've got lots of options. The pedagogy of my project, it is built on what Arroyo set up with growing tall poppies, and that physics is achievable for anybody. Stereotypes are just that, they're stereotypes. Show students, and girls in particular, that people from all interests and all backgrounds, male, female, they can do this, they absolutely can. That physics is achievable for everybody, as is aviation. Physics still has this weird reputation of being really super difficult. Oh my God, you have to be crazy brilliant to do physics. It's no harder than any other STEM subject.
Mm-hmm.
That is an absolute, you know, it's incorrect.
And one of the things that I always come back to with physics in particular, but a lot of the sciences in general, is that you're not just learning the science, but you're learning how to think. Because, you know, I won't go into the current political climate, and we've all heard about it, but just some of the things that have been said, I sit there thinking, a 10-year-old who's done basic, you know, 10-year-old science knows better logic than that. And it's the type of thinking that helps you not just in science, but in life.
Absolutely, and especially with social media as it is now, that's one of the things that perhaps more with sort of the year 7, 8, 9 kids as they're really starting to jump on Facebook and share things without thinking about it. That just, is that real? Does that actually make sense? You know, question it. Like, it's good to question things. And again, you know, science, it's curiosity, it's questioning, it's wanting to know why. Again, the 5, 6s, they're absolutely brimming over with it. It's brilliant. And then somehow they get a little bit older and they're less enthusiastic. But then you always get those glimmers, those giving them something like this that is hands-on, it's applied, it's giving them a real reason. Then the excitement suddenly comes back and they forget that they're supposed to be cool teenagers. But that's it, you know, it's where those stereotypes actually come from. Still not really worked out the answer because it's everywhere. It's, you know, oh, Girls can't do physics. Girls can't fly planes. Last time I checked, I was a girl, and I did both of those quite successfully. And I'm not the only one. I'm far from the only one. Girls are getting into engineering. You know, it's, again, the numbers might be less, but it's
just a historical thing, isn't it?
It is. It's a historical thing. But if we can change it with the kids at a younger level, then hopefully that will continue with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I reckon we stand a far better chance of enthusing 10-year-olds to 16-year-olds than we do re-enthusing a few adults.
So what's next for you on your journey with SciFly?
Well, it's going to be going on a temporary pause whilst I'm teaching full-time again next term. But that's a 10-week pause, so that's not a bad thing. And as part of that, the school that I will be at for 10 weeks, we're also hoping, again, just keeping the project ticking over, there's an opportunity for me to take what will be, it's an all-girls school, but take the Year 11 girls to have a go in the Qantas 737 simulator.
Oh, wow.
That's still in the planning stage, but the right contacts have been made. So even whilst I'm a full-time teacher again for 10 weeks, we're still going to hope to get that. And again, we're talking about they're doing kinematics and things in physics. And an example that we thought that they can actually try in the simulator is to calculate a theoretical acceleration of the plane and then try it. however many pounds of thrust that the plane will change that into newtons, so it matches what they're doing with physics. Do the calculations in the class and then get in the simulator and see what happens. So again, just taking what they're learning and put it into something real. And hey, look, if I'm a supervisor teacher going and I don't get to play in the 737, like seriously, that's, if I had that opportunity in year 11, it probably wouldn't have taken me until I was 32 to start flying. Just showing them that the opportunity's there and that they absolutely can do it.
Well, I can see the excitement. So Dr. Zara Dennis, teacher, aviator and female, successfully showing all of that can be done at once. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. There's also other information on the site, such as subscription details, both via iTunes and manually. If you want to support the show, have a look at the support the show link. You can make a donation via PayPal. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.